So here we go with capacitance sensors. Now, with capacitance sensors, again, you know, so I keep going back to displacement. That's a very common thing that we try to measure a lot of times. These are things that we use every day. You probably aren't even aware of it, but a capacitive sensor, not just one, but if we use an array of them, which is kind of shown in the background picture here, it allows us to know where something is being pressed. So if you can imagine the surface of a smartphone, you want to know where you're actually pushing. There actually is a translucent screen of either capacitive sensors, or there's actually another type of tech to do the same thing. A little refresher on capacitance. Capacitance is a function of dielectric properties and geometry. So we have a dielectric constant or permittivity of a certain material, epsilon. We also have a relative dielectric constant in air in a vacuum. So it's typically one. Most things are air applications. Otherwise, when you get into different types of things, it becomes a little different. And then we have the dielectric constant of a vacuum, which is a fixed number in farads and farads meters. And then we have the distance between plates. So if we have these plates that are really close together, we can measure the capacitance across those plates. Now, that distance, as it changes, effectively changes the capacitance. As the distance decreases, notice X is on the bottom, that means capacitance will increase, and vice versa. As the X increases, the capacitance will decrease. But you do have to keep those plates from not touching each other, otherwise you start conducting across them, which is a little different. And then, of course, the area, the effective area between the plates also plays a factor. Now, capacitive transducers, sometimes they'll put a fixed central plate and they'll have movable plates between sides. And so it modifies things a little bit, and you get this thing called a K ratio, where you get a change in capacitance with a change of X. And that's equal to a very similar equation before, but now it's a negative with X squared. And so we get the change in capacitance with change of X is negative C, where we have a capacitance number over X. So the whole point here is, again, we want to get a change in capacitance that we can measure with a change in X. Now, the other side of that is like, okay, so we have a change in capacitance. Great. Now what? That doesn't get us to voltage, right? It doesn't get us to current. So oftentimes what you have to do is, again, you have to apply a voltage, a fixed voltage across that capacitor so that you can measure another voltage out. So we have an input voltage again applied and an output voltage, which is VO here. In this case, it actually is a dynamic system, so we actually have time constant for this. So it's not a zero order sensor in this case. It's actually a first order system, which is why I have a time constant related to the fixed resistance and the capacitance. So we actually get one of those time constants, so we see how reactive it is. Now, typically, a resistor coming in, now this is, for those of you who aren't familiar with electronics, this is like an op-amp interface. Op-amps, which is where the little triangle is on the right, typically has a very high input impedance, roughly about 1 megaohm or so. And it should be much higher than the system you're trying to measure. So that's why we usually have those very high, so you can actually get an accurate measurement and you don't have a secondary effect going on there. Okay, so in that way we can change that to that. Now, a different version that's related to capacitance is what we call piezoelectricity. Now, this is kind of a unique type of material. A piezo is a material that has dipoles in them that you don't just get capacitance, you actually generate voltage based upon compressing something or expanding something. Now, piezoelectricity is great because you're generating electricity from that mechanical force, either compression or tension. You actually generate a voltage. However, it's not very much. You don't have a lot of range to move. So this is great for very, very, very small changes or displacements. So this is something that they'll use on microscopes. They'll use it on things where you have really tiny changes, and even in chips that you're trying to make slight tiny adjustments for mirrors and things like that at very, very small scales. You can also use it in microphones so that you can measure pressure waves. And so as pressure waves hit the microphone, it generates little voltage signals that you can then amplify, and then we can turn into, and then we can acquire that amplified signal and digitize it, and then we can replay it over speakers once we send it back out. We're going to get to play with that in one of our assignments. So piezos are quite cool. The other thing where they're used, like in medical environments, is a plethysmograph. And so this is where you have something that could be put on a finger, or it can be put on something that very slightly changes. But because the piezo can pick up those slight variations, you can find things like pulses or some type of volumetric measurements. So piezos are very much related. And so again, you have two conductive surfaces attached to a piezo. Now, piezos are traditionally have been crystals, sometimes crystals in form, so piezo crystals. However, there's now piezoplastics, so you can have a piezo material between conductive surfaces and be able to measure the force related to the displacement in. And again, they have various sensitivities. These are the general equations and the general dynamic. Again, it's a first order system, so you're going to have some lag. So if I press down immediately, it's going to take a very, very short time, but there's related to the time constant, five time constants to respond. And if I expand or I pull, same thing, there's going to be a time constant to respond. So just remember that with first order systems. And this is kind of what a piezo accelerometer can be. So you put some piezo material that's adhered to a mass and then a fixed component with a spring, and then you're going to get different voltages based upon when that mass moves. And so this is what an accelerometer design would look like. And so you can kind of see how, in the animation, what that looks like. All right. So that's it for capacitance and piezos. The next type we'll talk about is temperature.